for men and women who have faithfully worked for the kingdom and were waiting on God to do the new thing that He's promised to do. And the entire meat of this message, and we're going to give you just the meat, is that the battle belongs to the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. It's our job to plant and water, and it's God's job to bring the growth. And I say, God, bring it on. Amen?
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I'm ready for some growth, aren't you?
Amen.
I'm ready. I want to see more drug addicts' lives change. I want to see more alcoholics come to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I want to see families transformed. I want to see growth in the life of the pastor. I want to see people who've been serving the Lord for a long time find something new to chew on. God wants to do a new thing, amen? And I say, God, bring it on, baby. Bring it on. If you have your Bibles, Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, we're going to focus in on verses 21 and 22. As sure as anything, I'm going to give you the meat today. We're going to skip the dessert and the salad, and we're going to give you the meat. And we're going to go home encouraged, because as hard as we have been working for the kingdom, and as faithful as we are, there are those times we need to be reminded that God is on our side and the battle belongs to Him. As a matter of fact, 2 Chronicles says we don't even have to fight. The battle belongs to the Lord. So Mark chapter 2, would you stand with me for the reading of God's Word? Just two verses. Verses 21 and 22. Mark chapter 2, verses 21 through 22. No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, the new piece pulls away from the old, making the tear worse. And no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and both the wine and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wine skins. That is the red word of Jesus Himself. Jesus speaking about the new thing He wants to do in our lives. Father, thank You so much for Your presence here today. It's obvious and it's real and it's good. Would You now encourage Your people and remind us that we will reap a reward and a harvest if we do not give up. And all God's people said, amen, amen. You may be seated. Let's run through this very quickly. The whole idea of the new cloth, Jesus on purpose picks new cloth. You cannot attach new cloth to old cloth, because old cloth does not have the expandability. Old cloth cannot stretch. Old cloth is weathered. It makes no sense and does no one any good to attach something new like that to something old. And then Jesus moves into the wineskins. You cannot take brand new wine that will ferment. You cannot take brand new wine that grows and expands. You cannot take the newness of new wine and put it into an old wineskin, because wineskins were goatskin. And when goatskin dries up, it gets very rigid and very brittle, and that wine would grow and the wineskin would break. Again, another wonderful example of how you've got to take newness and give it to newness, so that the new thing that Jesus came to give us will not be fluttered away or wasted away or spilled away. And so I want to tell you, as true as the day is long, this congregation, I know it without a shadow of a doubt, this congregation is new cloth. This congregation is full of new wine skins. As a pastor, I'm proud and I'm honored to be involved with so many people who are dead set on allowing God to do a new thing. I know it. I talk to you. We're not attached to the past. We're not attached to old things. We're not attached to brittle and fragile things. As New Testament believers, we are all about the new. As New Testament believers, we are asking Jesus to come in here like a flood and fill us with His presence and help us to be the people He wants us to be. As we move forward, I want to encourage you, if we'll be patient and if we'll be faithful, God will usher in a new thing. But it's our job to plant, it's our job to water, and God brings about the growth. And I say, God, bring it on. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. No doubt about it. Pastor Bell, I can't imagine being in your shoes at times and the phenomenal effort and the phenomenal stick-to-itiveness that one has to have to plant a church with absolutely nobody. And I want to encourage you and your people today and let you know that if you'll remain faithful, you will continue to reap a reward if you do not give up. I'm telling you, there are more alcoholics that need to know about Jesus. There are more drug addicts that need to know that Jesus is still the only way to get to the only God. And for us English-speaking folk, let's be reminded today that it's our job to be faithful. It's God's job to bless our faithfulness. If we want God to do a new thing, He'll do it. Let's say, God, bring it on, Father. Bring it on. Amen. The problem is that we have experienced some really good times. In the last couple years, some good things have happened. But here's what I'm seeing. We're growing and we're experiencing the new thing inch by inch and not mile by mile. And most of us are mile by mile people. Do you catch my drift? I mean, God has done some really cool things. I want you to think back over the last couple years from where we've come. It's amazing what God has done. You are good people. God has positioned us to accomplish something great for the kingdom. But the problem is, with you and with me, we lack patience. We want mile by mile growth, and God wants us to settle for inch by inch growth and be satisfied and grateful with the work that He's doing. And I gotta tell you, I've got vision from laity coming at me from all sides. God has something up His sleeve. Good things are about to happen. It's our job to catch the vision, and God will provide His provision. I still believe it today. How about you? Amen.
Amen.
Do not give up, for at the proper time you will reap a reward if you do not give up. Progress and growth and expansion and newness has not come as quickly as some of us would like. In many ways, certain ministries and certain priorities have not come to life as quickly as we desire. But this one thing I know for sure, God can still be trusted, and we must not run ahead of His agenda. Amen? God can still be trusted. In many ways, we are the best kept secret in town. And it will not be long until the town sees the foundation that God has built here at 1604 South Medford Street. I got to tell you, Jimmy Rogers, I want God to bring in, to usher in, to blow in the new thing. I want it bad. If revival has to start, let revival start with me. Amen?
Amen.
You better believe it. No
doubt. Hallelujah.
But what can we do while we wait? Isn't it fun to wait? Do you have the gift of waiting? If you love to wait, say amen. When I'm at Walmart, Pat, I'm in line, waiting for 2 hours, I just say to myself, I love to wait. This is great. Thank you for the wink. Why do we go to Walmart? Are we gluttons for punishment? That's what I want to know. But waiting upon the Lord. What can we do while we wait for God to blow in here and help us break out? Well, I'm glad you asked. I think some of us, if not all of us, need to keep on being willing to take the blame. Now, you're saying, what in the world are you talking about? You know, when we talk about, oh, dear old prophet, you're to blame. It's a bad connotation. In our society, when you start blaming someone, it gets really ugly. But I think in the church world, in this New Testament environment, God is asking some of us to take the blame, to keep the foundation solid, so that when God does come rushing in like a mighty wind, we'll be ready and we'll be willing and we'll be able to build on what He wants to do. I'm telling you, folks, the time is near. God is faithful. Let's keep on keeping on. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Look at a person to your left and say, yo, are you willing to take the blame? Acts chapter 8, verse 2. It's in your notes. On that day, the day that Stephen was murdered, a great persecution broke out against the church at Jerusalem. And all except the apostles were scattered. They were scattered. What were they? They were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him. Let me paint this picture. We're going to move on. We're going to celebrate. We're going to go home. Here we go. Stephen was honored for his death as the church's first martyr. Now, accepted Jewish law did not allow Jews to mourn for criminals who were put to death by stoning, and that's exactly what Stephen was in the eyes of the law. He was a criminal, and there was to be no mourning. There was to be no burial. Faithful church members, they risked their lives to bury Stephen. Faithful church members, they risked their lives by publicly lamenting over Stephen's death. No one held Stephen personally responsible for the difficult days that the church was enduring, even though the persecution of the church began on the day of his death. Now, follow me here. Persecution of the church began on the day that Stephen died. This is the truth. Stephen, in a good way, was totally to blame for what was going on inside and outside of the church. Stephen's life and Stephen's death ignited a rampage of religious persecution against the followers of Jesus. And as a result of Stephen's death, and as a result of the persecution, the church was forced to scatter, and they ended up fulfilling the mission that God had for the church the entire time. Stephen's existence and his lack thereof moved the church from stillness into tsunami mode. Stephen lived, Stephen died, and thus the church did come alive. The church moved into the position where God wanted it to be. Because of Stephen, it was all Stephen's fault. Stephen was to blame because he lived, because he died. The church would never be the same. And I say, Randy, while we're waiting for God to blow in here and do what only He can do, I'm looking for people to take the blame with me for us being ready. If you're with me on this, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We've prayed. Iglesia del Nazareno and the English-speaking church, we've prayed. We are expecting a new thing from God. But our situation seems to be a scenario where the new thing has come inch by inch and not mile by mile. What can we do as we wait upon the Lord to bring us a revival of epic proportion? All of us must be willing to take the blame for the eventual revival that generations to come will be able to write about. I just wonder, as we finish crossing the Dead Sea with our eyes on the Promised Land, who is willing to be blamed with me for our church being positioned to accept a mighty move of God where people are saved and saints are sanctified? Oh, if it has to be my fault, I'll take blame today. But if you're with me on this, say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
This would be a good thing to be blamed for. Pastor Don, it's all your fault. The church is growing, and it's all your fault. Praise the Lord. Who wants to be blamed for this church still being the most loving church in town when God's Holy Spirit blows in here like a flood?
Amen.
Who wants to be blamed for church unity when God's Holy Spirit comes blowing in here like a rushing mighty wind? Who wants to be accused of being so filled with God's Holy Spirit that kindness oozes off of every fiber in your being? Who wants to be totally responsible for us staying community focused? Who wants to be blamed for fostering harmony and patience within the church body? Who wants to be accused of not judging their pew neighbor? Who wants to be totally responsible for us being ready when God decides to blow in here and help us break out?
Amen.
I stand amazed at the power of one person. To throw water on the fire or gas on the fire. And I gotta tell you, Randy, whether we realize it or not, all of us are walking around with 2 gallon containers, one full of fire and one full of water. And I gotta tell you, when good things are happening, I wanna be a fire breather, I wanna be a fire blower, I wanna be a gas thrower, I want the fire to flame, the flame to burn even brighter. How about you? Amen? It's amazing the difference of one person. Now, come on now. Who is so serious about their relationship with Jesus that they're willing to take the blame with me so that when God's Holy Spirit comes, the foundation will be so solid and so good that we'll be able to break out and go forth and do what God wants you to be? I'll take the blame. How about you? Amen. Ten little Christians standing in line. One disliked the preacher, and then there were 9. 9 little Christians stayed up very late. One overslept on Sunday, and then there were 8. 8 little Christians on their way to heaven. One took the low road, and then there were 7. 7 little Christians chirping like chicks. One disliked the music. Then there were 6. 6 little Christians seemed very much alive, but one lost his interest, and then there were 5. 5 little Christians pulling for heaven's shore. One stopped to rest, and then there were 4. Four little Christians, each busy as a bee. One got his feelings hurt, and then there were three. Three little Christians knew not what to do. One joined the sporty crowd, and then there were two. Two little Christians, our rhyme is nearly done. They differed with each other, shame on them, and then there was one. The pastor of El, one little Christian, cannot do much, 'tis true. But that one brought his friend to a Bible study, and then there were two. Two earnest Christians, each one more. That doubled the number, and then there were four. Four sincere Christians worked early and late, each one another, and then there were eight. Eight splendid Christians, if they doubled as before, in just eight little Sundays, they'd have 1,024. Folks, I gotta tell you, Ken Smith hit the nail on the head this morning in the hallway. It's time for personal evangelism to come back to life in the life of the New Testament church. And we've got more programs, and we've got more activities, and we've got more events than you can shake a stick at. But I gotta tell you, the best way to still build our church is for people to see a difference in you, and when they notice the difference, you can tell them that Jesus still saves drug addicts and alcoholics, and it solves marital problems. Folks, let's find people that need to know about Jesus and let them know He is still the only way to get to the only God. Amen?
Amen.
The silliest thing I've ever read in a message, but it's mind-boggling that one person, eight Sundays, doubling 1,024, had nothing to do with Easter egg hunts and breakfasts and yada yada yada, and had everything to do with people getting on fire for Jesus and inviting people to their own personal area of influence. Amen? And I know, hey, I'm just like you. Most of my friends are Christians. Well, God told me this morning, Pastor Don, you need to make some more friends.
Amen.
You get that?
Amen.
It's so easy for all of us to say, oh, Pastor Don, all my friends are believers. Well, hey, I say this respectfully and with great vision and love, we need to make some more friends.
Amen.
Where there's at least one person that we rub shoulders with that doesn't know Jesus. If you're with me, say good preaching, Pastor Don.
Good preaching.
Every golden era of human history stemmed from the devotion and righteous passion of a single individual. There are no bona fide mass movements at the center of every great historical revival. You'll find one person that got fired up. D.L. Moody once said, "The world has yet to see what God can do with and for and through and in one person who is fully and wholly consecrated to Him." That's humbling to me. I want to take the blame, Daryl. I want people to look back and say, Don Schulteis, I've said it before, he was an aging, balding, weight-gaining man. How could God use him to help lead a great church? And people would see in the footnotes, it's because a bunch of laity stood to his left and stood to his right, and they were willing to take full responsibility that the church would be ready when the Holy Spirit came blowing in like a rushing wind. I'm sorry about this, but I've been your pastor for 677 days. That seems like a long time, doesn't it? Someone said amen over there. Was that you, Jimmy? We're not what we were, but we certainly not. We're not what we want to be, but we're certainly not what we were. Amen? We've had ebbs and we've had flows and we've had more flows and ebbs. And we've won a lot, we've lost a few, we've had good thoughts and we've had weird thoughts, and we've tried everything under the sun, from swallowing flaming swords to jumping through fiery circles. But I still think that all of us need a friend that don't know Jesus, and I want to be responsible for one new family in the next 2 months. I want Daryl to look at me and say, Pastor Don, it's your fault that that family's here. Woo! Wouldn't that be awesome?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
The only thing I know, you know, my mind is weird. It's 5 after. I'm almost done, I promise. I gave you the meat. There it was. My mind works in weird ways. I know you don't believe that, but it does. As far, Janae, the only thing I can think of right now for us as a church is to close the book on the first 20 months, 22 months, and open up a new book today. We're ready for a mighty blowing of God's Holy Ghost. The only way I know to do it, Pastor Abel, is to close the chapter on what's behind us and open up a new book in regards to what lies before us.
Amen.
You know, it's Pastor Appreciation Sunday, but in a lot of ways it's Congregation Appreciation Sunday. I mean, you ought to be applauded for living with me for this many months. Good for you. Congratulations. Could we pray this morning before we go? Pastor Bell and Luce, come on, hon. Come on down here, would you?
Yeah.
Iglesia del Nazareno, I want you to come up here and surround Pastor Bell and Luce right here at the altar. Come on up here. My wife isn't in here, so I'll be by myself, but I'd like for the church board and my Sunday school class and the entire church body to gather around me. I'm going to ask that Ken Smith would come and pray from the pulpit, a time of closing prayer. Let's make room for everybody. Folks, we're closing the book on the first 20 months, and we're moving on now for a brand new chapter. God has big things in store for us. That was my one-point sermon that I don't even know what it was about, but there it is. Would you pray with me, church board, Sunday school? Church body, Ken Smith is going to pray from the pulpit. I'm not sure he heard me. Folks, let's reach in. Let's reach up to heaven right now. Iglesia del Nazareno, pray for your pastor, for Pastor Abel Luce, and my church family. Pray for us, and pray for me, and pray for our relationships, and for our church, and for great vision from God. Let's just reach up to heaven and pray the fire down, folks. Join in with us as Ken leads.
Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We thank you for your loving kindness and your peace and your mercy and your forgiveness. Lord, this morning we feel like we've touched the hem of your garment. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that has been a part of our worship here today in so many ways. Lord, we thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ on the cross, for the who gave his blood for the remission of our sins. We thank you, Lord, for the gift of forgiveness that you allow us to exhibit with each other. We thank you for the forgiveness you allow us to express to others. We thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit that dwells within us, that guides our every action. I pray this morning your special blessings is upon our pastors, both Pastor Don and Pastor Bell and their families. We thank you for the leadership. We just pray, Lord, as we surround them with our love and we uphold their arms as they get tired, Lord, we're going to be there to support them in every way possible. We thank you for the privilege that we have to be a part of your body. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be a part of a baptism service this morning where lives are on exhibit for the power of God in lives, Lord, and delivery from sin and oppressions and addictions. Lord, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are the one that we praise and glorify. We thank you for the opportunity we have to live in this community. We thank you for the opportunity we have to expand and touch lives through loving and Christian Mission Service Center and through all the other agencies, Lord, that are providing needs for people in need. We thank you for that privilege, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for every good thing, Lord. We know it comes from your hand. And we thank you, Lord, for the lives that are at the altars today. I pray that every need would be met. I pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit would touch in each instance whatever the need is, that would be accomplished, and that you would guide and direct every life, Lord, back to where you want us to be with our lives. And as we leave here today and we enter into our life and enter into the obligations and the acquaintances and the people that we have influence over, we pray that our light would shine brightly, Lord, for you, that they would notice that there's something different, that we care about them, that we love them, and that you would use us to glorify and spread your kingdom throughout this city. I pray, Lord, that this church would be a shining light on the hill, Lord, that you would just take and magnify our efforts. And as long as we have your word and your truth, that the results would all go to you, that we would not feel like that it's necessary for us to produce, that we just realize that it's our obligation and privilege, Lord, to follow your leading every day, to die daily, to allow you to exhibit yourself through our life. And when we do that, the results are in your hand. They're not in our hands, Lord. We give them gladly to you. And then we bask in the freedom that comes from turning our lives over to you, to saying, yes, you're God. You're the God of all the ages. And you have all the answers. And you just need us to enter into fellowship and enjoy your presence every day in our life. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the privilege that we have to serve you. Hallelujah to the name of Jesus. Glory to the God of the ages. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.